Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to welcome Carmen here. Too bad it's not in person. In the past, we combined to Carmen to visit Brazil, but not work. But I think in the future is possible. So let me introduce Carmen. Carmen Armeiro is professor of statistics and operation research at the University of Valencia, Spain, and biomathematics and statistics Scotland Associate. Her research has always been focused on Bayesian inference and survival analysis. And another things. She has published papers in prestigious international journals such as Statistical Medicine, Statistical Medical Research, Biometric Journal, among others. She is director of the Valencia Bayesian Research Group and of the Valencia International Bayesian Analysis Summit School. Carmen, thank you so much for your accepting my invite. Feel free to present.
Thank you. Boa tarde. Estou muito feliz em participar desse seminário português. gostaria de agradecer à professora Vera pelo maravilhoso convite. Eu e a Vera nos conhecemos há muito tempo e um prazer revelar. Mesmo que seja na tela. Tentarei que este seminário não seja excessivamente técnico e por isso irei me concentrar mais nos conceitos do que nas fórmulas.
Ai. Okay, so beautiful.
Bravo.
Eu sou uma boa professora.
Alunta. Hola. This talk is about survival models and Bayesian statistics. You know that survival times are times between an initiating event and an event or a point of interest. We will start by introducing some basic survival concepts. Then we will discuss competing risk in models and we will present two different studies. The first one is a basic competing risk model that tries to analyze the evolution of elder people who have suffered a hip fracture. The second one is a longitudinal model that incorporates a competing risk model for assessing non-ignorable missing data in a study about chronic renal disease in Valencian children. Then we will move to multi-state models, and in particular, the illness and death models, which are the simplest multi-state models and possibly the most easier. We will revisit the hip fracture study, but from an illness and death perspective. And finally, we'll present some work in a very informal way that is in progress and that includes random effects and spatial elements into the hip fracture study. All the material in this talk is within the Bayesian statistics, and you know that is a statistical methodology which is based on the Bayesian conception of the probability that allows the quantification of a lot of elements like random events, random variables, parameters, hypotheses, models, or missing data, always in probabilistic terms. And now we are explaining some of the characteristics of survival times. They are always positive, they are often censored, and they are usually skewed. Possibly the main characteristic of the survival times is censoring, which occurs because when we observe the survival times, we need to use a lot of time in order to observe the event of interest for all people in the sample. The usual situation is that at the end of the study, the event of interest has occurred for some people, but not for all of them. And we will have two different types of data. We will have complete data for the individuals that have experienced the event of interest, but also we will have not complete data, sensual data, for those individuals that at the end of the study have not experienced the event of interest. Censoring is, at least for frequency statistics, is the main responsible for all the survival methods are very different than the traditional statistical methods. And of course, with this situation, the normal distribution, which is the most popular, has not a role, and any role here in this type of models. There are two concepts that are the most popular for characterizing the random behavior of random variables, here survival times. These two concepts are the survival function and the hazard function. The survival function is a probability that account for the uncertainty associated to not having the event of interest in a period of time. It starts at 1 and decreases until 0 when the time goes to infinity. The hazard function is the instantaneous rate of the occurrence of the event of interest among all the population that at that moment has not experienced the event of interest, is at risk. This hazard function is a rate, is not a probability, but is defined in terms of a conditional probability. Because it's a rate, it is always positive and can be greater than one. Even the hazard function is not a probability, we more or less we can think in a instantaneous probability of experiencing the event of interest, given that the individual has not experienced the event of interest a bit before. We have spoken about statistics and censoring, but what is the role of censoring in Bayesian inference? We recall a bit the general protocol of the Bayesian statistics. We have a quantity of interest that, and we are interested in learning about it. We need, of course, a sampling model that connect the observable variables, in this case the survival times, to the quantity of interest. And we need also, to start in all the process, a prior distribution for the quantity of interest that contains all the information or no information that we have about the parameter before the data. Then we have the experiment, we have the data, and you know that we have the two different type of data, complete data and censored data. Then we can compute the likelihood function of the quantity of interest, and then we, at the end, we can compute using the Bayes' theorem the posterior distribution for quantity of interest. And we can see that the censoring is important for constructing the likelihood function because it depends on the data. And then it's important for constructing the posterior distribution. But plays not a role when we have to elicit a prior distribution or in the interpretation of the posterior distribution. This is more or less some basic survival elements, and then we move, we start to speaking about competing risk models. Competing risk models are survival models that includes more than one event of interest. In these models, the individuals in the study are followed from a common initial state until the occurrence of the first of these events. This first occurrence is always the minimum of the survival times associated to each of the events that are in the competition. We also need some indicator to know what has been the event of interest. There are different methodological approaches for dealing with competitive risk models. We will use the cause-specific hazard model.
Carmen, please, put it in full screen, please.
Okay, sorry. Yes?
No, the same, no, no problem.
We are speaking about competitive risk model, and we have explained that there are different methodological approaches to deal with these models. And the most popular, possibly the easier also, and the more connected to multi-state models is the cause-specific hazard models that use mainly two key concepts. The first is the cause-specific hazard function, and the second one is the cumulative incidence function for each event. The cause-specific hazard function is a hazard, in particular the hazard of experiencing the event in the presence of the rest of events that are in the competition. The cumulative incidence function for each event is a probability, in particular the probability of experiencing the event in a given period of time. We have rate, we have hazard, and we have probabilities. Now I would like to present you the first of our study in competing risk. It is a basic study, and is related to hip fracture in elder people. This is an important health problem because elder people with a hip fracture not only has this problem, but also have a higher risk of fracture and also have a higher risk of death. We have information of a lot of people from the Valencian region, more than 34,000 people, age 65 or more, that were discharged alive from the hospital for a hip fracture from January 2008 until December 2015. The study ended a bit late in December 2016. We consider as for the study as time zero, a personal time, that was the time in which each patient was discharged from the hospital. You know that we are working with other people. Here we know that the mean of the age where the fracture, the first fracture was produced was 83 years, a bit more. And more or less our patients were followed for a 5 years in median. We have women, we have men, we have about three times more women than men. The women that refracture, this second refracture, is we have a percentage that is between 7 and 8. This quantity is a bit smaller in the case of men, about the 6% of the men refracture, but about the 47% of the women death, but about 59 more men die. It's clear that the women refracture more, but women die more. Of course, that doesn't up some one because there are people that were fractured but have not experienced a refracture are alive.
Tem alguma motivação de muito mais mulher ter o problema de
I don't know what is the name in English, but it's osteoporosis. The bones in the women are not are not very good. Men have in general better bones than women. We have osteoporosis. I don't know what is the name in English.
It's true. It's true. Yes. Osteoporosis.
Yes. Yes. And this is our problem. This is the study, and we use as the sampling model. We use a competing risk model for the two possible transition from fracture to refracture, from fracture to death, and we use a Cox model with a coverage to be a woman or a man, an age. And also, we consider a waveful baseline for the two hazard rates. And because we are working within the Bayesian framework, we know that the model is not complete until we elicit a prior distribution. Okay, we need for completing a Bayesian model, the sampling model, but also the prior distribution. In this case, our parameters of interest are the regression coefficients and all the parameters in the baseline hazard function. And we consider a scenario of prior independence and non-informative. We don't want to add prior information. And we use a normal distribution, very wide, very flat, for the regression coefficients. And also we use a gamma distribution for the parameters of the waveful distribution. And we compute the posterior distribution using MCMC, but also because we are learning ILNA, we have used ILNA. And here we have some of the results that we have had. This probability is the cumulative incidence function for the event K. This is a probability that depends on the quantity of interest, theta, and we know about theta, we have some information that is in the posterior distribution. Then we can compute the posterior distribution of this cumulative incidence. Okay. And we can describe this posterior distribution in very different ways. But here we only present the posterior mean of this cumulative incidence function for refracture and for death. Here we have the posterior mean of the cumulative incidence function for refracture for women and for men. And for men, we consider three different ages, women with 70 years, 80 years, 90 years, and also for all them, vale? Okay? And we know that in the case of refracture for women, the age is not very important. And also it seems that it's the same for men. If we compare women and men, we have the same situation that we have explained, that in general, refracture more women than men. Okay. In the case of death, the situation is not the same. Age is important for death, and for women and for men. But it's clear that men have more the probabilities are higher, and then they death more than women. In particular, if we see this interval of time, 0 to 2 years, we have that death in men increase a lot. Of course, mainly with people with 90 years. And now we discuss the other competent risk model. It's very different. It's in reality it's a longitudinal model. It's a longitudinal model that tries to analyze the glomerular filtration rate. This is a biomarker for chronic kidney disease. And in general, high values of the glomerular filtration rate indicate that the healthy of condition of the child is good, and lower values indicate that the condition is not very good. We have data also from Valencia, from the follow-up of 168 children that with this disease, and these children, when after being diagnosed, they are followed during the time. The temporal scale for the study is time in years since the child was diagnosed with the disease, and of course, time zero will be the time of diagnosis. Here we have the spaghetti plot, we have time, and we have here the glomerular filtration rate of the different children in logarithmic scale, and we only see variability. We appreciate a great variability in the entrance when a child is diagnosed with disease, and we have children that are not very good and children that are not very bad. Okay, we have also children that even having diagnosed. And of course, have been followed, we didn't have information about his or her follow-up. This is the case, for example, of this child. This child was, we have only information of this child after more or less 12 years of her or his diagnosis. Okay? I think that the data was terrible. There was some bureaucracy and some, okay, not very good situation. The data that we have, I know that are good data, but we have a lot of lost data. This was, I love this problem because it was the first time that I discovered longitudinal model and we know nothing about them. And we started to learn. And at the end, we consider different models. And at the end, the best or the more, the better model for us is, I don't know if it is the best. It was for modeling the glomerular filtration rate, it was a longitudinal linear mixing model where the glomerular filtration rate for each child at each time was expressed as the addition of four elements. Here, the first element is an element with the coverage. In this case, it seems that the relevant coverage were the etiology of the disease, the gender, the age at diagnosis, and if the child is taking or not hypertension medication. We also, it was clear that we need a random effect associated to the intercept, that is when the child is diagnosed. We have seen in the figure that we have a lot of variability, and we expect that this element capture this variability. And also we saw that here that there are a lot of children that have a lot of variability in the measurement, and we would like an element that can capture this variability. And this was a bit more difficult because it's a stochastic process, it depends on the time, but at the end we consider that a Brownian motion was a good election. And of course the random error, because we are here in the normal scenario. We were very happy, we continue learning about the longitudinal model, and we discovered that the missing data was a very key issue in this type of models. And of course, we had missing data. We had missing data generated by non-ignorable patterns, because we had children that are aware bad and bad and bad and bad, and then leave the system and went to dialysis. Also, there were some children that improved and at the end leave also the follow-up, but because they were discharged. And also, we have this situation in which we have not the information of this child and this moment. But if we have this here information, is because this child is alive, and this is also information that we need to enter in the model. Then we decided to model this missing mechanism because we thought that they were important. And we model dropout. to go to the dialysis or to be discharged by means of a competing risk model. Children that are in the follow-up leave the system because they are discharged or because they are sent to dialysis, and then we model the dropout as a survival competition risk model. This time, say we will use a cost model for these times, and here we have the coverage of course the random effect associated to the entrance of the child in the system, and also the Brownian emotion, and also we include the left truncation for the loss of the follow-up times that we have seen in the early periods of the disease. To Bayesian to work with left truncation is difficult when you don't work in the Bayesian framework, but if you work in the framework of the left, if you are working from a Bayesian point of view, the truncation is not easy. It's not difficult. Okay. Okay, and then we have a sampling model, a bit different, more complex. We have two parts, the longitudinal linear mixing model and the model for the dropout. Then we have a vector of parameters and hyperparameters longer. Here we have the three variabilities, random effect, for the serial correlation, and for the measurement. And also, we need, in order to complete the model, a prior distribution for all these quantities, and also we consider a non-informative scenario, and we consider prior independence. The marginal prior distributions were the same, except that here we have the standard deviation and we will use a uniform distribution. And with this, the sampling model, the data and the prior, we compute the posterior distribution. Here is for the parameters and hyperparameters, but also for the latent elements. Some results that we obtained from this analysis. Here we have the posterior mean and the 90% credible interval for the three standard deviation, for the standard deviation associated to the random effect that at the intercept, it is the great variability. Then we have around this variability that is associated to the serial correlation, to the movement of the glomerular filtration rate of a child during the follow-up. And here, this is the smaller. Is associated to the random to the error of the measurement. And here we have the posterior overall mean of the glomerular in children without hypertension with regard to gender. Here the boys, here the girls, and the theology. We don't appreciate the great difference between boys and girls. And also with regard to the theology, it's possible that this theology is not so serious. This is a structure. It's not serious as the other, but there are not great differences. And now, we enter in the world of the multi-state models. Multi-state models are also survival models, complex, more complex. They focus on the complete event history in situations when there are many survival times, many events of interest, and many connections between them. The simplest of these models is the so-called illness and death model. In this illness and death models, we have only three events of interest. They are a starting event, they are an intermediate and transitory event, and they are a terminal event, absorbent event. We can go, or we can move from the starting event to event 3 directly, or passing through the state 2. I think these models are very attractive because they are very connected. They can be formulated and they can be considered as stochastic processes. And stochastic processes, you know, has a lot of tools, has a lot of research, and these models are very powerful because they are all the work of the stochastic processes helping them. In particular, the illness and death model, that will be our model, can be formulated as a Markovian discrete stochastic process in continuous time, and only with three states, 1, 2, and 3. And you know that the concept that determines, that characterizes the behavior, the random behavior of a stochastic process, of a Markovian stochastic process, is the transition probabilities. The transition probabilities are connected to the hazard functions, and the hazard functions are connected to the transition probabilities. Then with this double connection, we can connect the work of the survival models and the work of the stochastic processes. And then we can move here, from here. Okay. Then with this, we are using these models, the illness and death model, to look the problem of the hip fracture. We have considered a competing risk model before, but of course the natural look, the natural treatment would be illness and death model. A person that is has a fracture and is life and discharge can be in this time, in this state for a long time, or can refracture again, or can death. If has another refracture, can be in this situation a long time, and also can go to death. Of course, this is a simplification because a person can have a fracture, a refracture, a second refracture, etc., etc., etc. Here we can put more refractures. Okay. And the sampling model will be the same for fracture to refracture, fracture to death. But we have to include, to consider the transition refracture to death. And we consider a hazard rate in terms also of the Cox model. And we need, in order to complete the Bayesian model, the a prior distribution, that they will be we have used the same situation, no prior distribute, no prior information, prior independence, etc., etc., to obtain the posterior distribution. And we have here some results. We also look for the cumulative incidence function for the different events, like before. This is a probability that depends on the quantity of interest, and we have the posterior distribution of the quantity of interest. Then we can compute, we can consider the posterior distribution of all these probabilities, all these cumulative incidents. But also, because we are in the multi-state framework, we can compute, we know that we have all the transition probabilities from the state, from one state to another state, and also these probabilities depend on the quantity of interest. Then we can compute the posterior distribution of every transition probability. And here we have for women and for men. We have this part, okay, this curve, for example, in six will be the posterior mean of the cumulative incidence function for refracture. This is, there is a probability that is near 0.10 that a person, a woman has refracture before time six. And here, this curve is the posterior mean of the transition probability from fracture, from the initial state to refracture. A person that has is refracture with a probability more or less 0.05. Then we have that until 6 years, this is the probability of having refracture, and here is the probability of being in this state. Then all these people has died, has went to from refracture to death. Okay? And this is the same for men. Then we can compare posterior incidents and also with posterior probabilities of transition. And also we have here a table with some information. This will be the posterior mean and a 0.95 credible interval for 1 year. Cumulative incidence of refracture, death without refracture, and death after refracture. And we have the means with regard to age, 70, 80, and 90, and also with regard to the gender. And we can appreciate that it's women refracture a bit more, but the probability is very, very low, okay? The situation here is very different with men, we know, and we have observed before, and we have quantities from fracture to death for the 3 ages for women, this quantity, and these values for men are higher. And finally, when a person is refractory, the probability that in a year go to death for women and for men is less for women in general than for men. Of course, for men, when a man has 90 years, he is in very bad condition. But a woman with this age is not at this very bad condition. Okay? Even has refractory. And a bit for finishing, we want to continue with this problem, the hip fracture study, because we have a lot of data, and we have data from the different departments of health in the region of Valencia. You can see where I am. I am here. This is the Mediterranean Sea, and this is the region of Valencia that Danilo, La Jefa Suprema, and Vera know. And we are here. And we are doing spatial statistics with multi-state models. This is our work. Yeah, and of course, we need to enter in the hazard, not only the coverage, but also random effects associated to the different locations, but also spatial events, and we are working in this problem. We would like to obtain some maps like this. This is the posterior mean for the cumulative incidence of refracture in 5 years, and we have the different departments of health of the region of Valencia. And this we have the dark areas has more refracture. It seems that they are older people. And also here, this is a part with a lot of two elder people that are from the UK, Germany, okay? And this is, we are working with these models. There are a lot of work to do, but we are happy. And I will explain more about that in a future conference. And I would like only all the material of the talk, a part of material is here in these two papers. This is a paper from and more older, and this is all that we are working with the hip fracture. Fran Llopis Cardona is an student, thesis student, and muy obligada a all the coauthors and the Ministerio de Ciencia e Innovación en Spain, a todas las personas que te han escuchado esta conferencia. Y está, finish.
Thank you, Carmi.
Muito obrigada.
De nada.